Okay, so now we can go through and follow our two consonant rule and see what we've got. So we've got the two consonants here, but we already had that marked. What about here? Mm-hmm. Nope. Yeah. Nope.
Yes.
Yes, we've got an RP. Good. No. No.
Yes.
Yes, we've got an M and a D. Good. Remember, if they're in separate words, that doesn't matter. What about here?
No.
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 No. No. Good. All right, let's go to the next one. What about here?
No.
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 Yes.
What's going on here?
It's an elision.
An elision, okay. So we drop the end of this word, and we do have two consonants. So somebody rightly said yes there, because this is eliding, and then we've got the two consonants. All right, here?
Yes.
Yes.
No.
We don't have the two consonants, but yeah, as Katie says, we know the nature of the os, os, and ace endings. So if you knew that, you could go ahead and mark it. What about here?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes, we have the position with the T and the Q. I remember Q, U count together as one consonant, but we have this consonant plus the Q, U, so that's two. Here?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yes, we've got the D and the T. Here?
No.
No?
No.
No. Okay. Now we can go back and see what we've got. Now here, before this dactyl, where are we going to divide, before or after the T?
Before.
Before, good. If you've got a single consonant in between syllables, the consonant goes with the following. And that applies even if you have to separate a word. Good. All right. And let's see what we can fill in here. You might know here, okay, tempora here, you can tell that's a neuter plural ending. So then the mea is also going to be a neuter plural ending. So what are these two syllables going to do?
Short,
short. Because we've got to have that neuter plural short A to agree with this, to my times. All right, where do we divide here?
Before the P.
Before the P again. All right, and we've got two syllables left there. We've got four syllables in a row there. We know this is long. Do you guys know the prefix day?
Yes.
Is that long or short?
Long.
It's actually long. Day is a long prefix. As a preposition, it's long. As a prefix, it's long. Day is always long. So if you didn't know that, it's a good thing to know because it occurs all over the place. So learning a little thing like that can really help you out down the line. Just knowing, you know, the length of one prefix can often help you out in enough to get the rest of the line in. What about de ducite? Obviously, this is an imperative. And we know the final TE of the imperative. Is that E long or short?
Short.
It is short. Good. And on an infinitive, the RE, the E is short. Okay? Almost always a final E is short in Latin. The exceptions to that would be de, the preposition we just talked about, and also a fifth declension word like DA, the ablative case, or RE, the ablative case. Other than those, pretty much every single final E in Latin is going to be short. So, this is short. If we know that's short, then we know the syllable before it has to be?
Short.
Short, because you can't have one short. You have to have two in a row. So, then we know that this syllable must be?
Long.
Long, because you have to have a long syllable before the two shorts. All right, and now we divide before the single consonant. So, now we've got another foot here. We can divide between the vowels. All right, and now we've got two syllables left here. What do we do with them?
Short, short.
Short, short. Excellent. Now we go down here. Well, we've got a whole sequence of longs here. We've got a dactyl here. We can divide before the single consonant. That's leaving us a couple syllables there. What can we do with that?
Short, short.
Short, short. Excellent. So now we've got that, and now we divide between this consonant and the QU, which counts as one. And we've got another foot, and we've got another foot. And we've got two syllables left, so what do they have to be?
Short, short,
short. Short, short. So I mentioned that the final E's are short. So on Mare, that's another example of that. It would be a short E. Here it gets a lot of E now, but just so you know. Again, the exceptions to that short E as a final E would be day, the preposition, or the ablative singular case of a fifth declension word. All right, excellent. Now, guys, so there's something interesting here about the word order. You've got the verb in the middle, and you've got nouns at the end, and you've got adjectives at the beginning, and notice they crisscross, OK? Okay, so perpetuum goes with carmen, neuter singular. Tempora goes with mea, neuter plural. What rhetorical device is that when we do the crisscross? It starts with an S.
Syndeton? Synchisis.
Synchisis. Chiasmus is the one where if we had the two adjectives in the middle and the nouns on the outside, that would be chiasmus. That's another type of fancy word. Now, also, this is an example of what's called a golden line. A golden line has a verb in the middle, and it has adjectives and nouns on the far ends. They go with each other. Poets love these kinds of lines, and Ovid is just full of them. Virgil's full of them. So this is actually called a golden line. Again, that's a verb in the middle. And then, let's see, two nouns and two adjectives, sorry. Split by that verb. So typically what you see is this kind of sentencing, synchisis arrangement where you have the adjectives on one side of the verb and you have the nouns on the other. You could have the chiasmus though, and that's another fancy word order too. But again, either way, it would be called a golden line. Poets love it. It's not something you typically see in prose, because in prose you either have the verb at the beginning if it's emphatic or at the end in a normal Latin sentence.
Oh, so sorry.
In this next line, before the sea and the lands and the sky, which covers all things. What rhetorical device is that?
Personification.
No. Personification. I could see a little bit. I mean, it's kind of weak because covers can't doesn't necessarily imply that. I don't think we're saying ekphrasis because it's not describing. It's saying before these.
It's like a metaphor.
Tricolon. Okay, this is the main one I was thinking about. And not only tricolon, but tricolon
crescens,
because the third one is emphasized by the addition of the descriptive clause, adjectival clause. It's tricolon, and we've also got these ets in here, so you could call it polysyndeton.